नमस्ते बिटिया, माई सेल्फ जेवीएन नेहा सैनी फ्रॉम फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक ज्योति विद्यापीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी। हेयर आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट द एनाटॉमी ऑफ द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड। स्पाइनल कॉर्ड इज़ द मेन पाथवे फॉर इन्फॉर्मेशन कनेक्टिंग द ब्रेन एंड द पेरिफेरल नर्वस सिस्टम। इट इज़ एलोंगेटेड सिलेंड्रिकल एंड इट इज सस्पेंडेड इन द वर्टिब्रल कैनाल एंड प्रोटेक्टेड बाय वर्टिब्री। इट इज़ सराउंडेड बाय मेनिंजेस एंड CSF। The three function of the spinal cord is transmission of nerve signals between the brain and the rest of the body via the sensory, motor and local reflexes. So the length is 45 centimeters long and it extends from foramen magnum up to intervertebral disc between L1 and L2. In the newborn it extends up to L3 vertebra. It occupies upper two-thirds of the vertebral canal and it is surrounded by three meninges, that is outer side dura mater, in the middle arachnoid, and the innermost is pia mater. CSF is found in the subarachnoid space. Subarachnoid means the space between dura mater and the arachnoid. Dura mater, arachnoid and the pia mater is the subarachnoid space. So you have to remember that in between the arachnoid and the pia mater we have the space known as subarachnoid space, in which we find the CSF. So this is the spinal cord, as you can see in the image, and it is continuous above with the medulla oblongata, and at the lower end it is tapered, and this tapering end is known as bonus medullaris. It is connected to coccyx by a non-neuronal cord which is known as phylum terminale. So this is conus medullaris. The space inside the conus medullaris is known as terminal ventricle. The spinal cord gives rise to 31 pairs of the spinal nerves, and the bundle of spinal nerves extending from the lumbosacral enlargement and conus medullaris surround the phylum terminale and forms the cauda equina. Spinal cord is segmented, that it contains cervical segment, thoracic, lumbar, sacral and coccygeal segments. So there are 8 cervical segments, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral and 1 coccygeal segment. It presents 2 enlargements in the cervical region. To supply the upper limb it gets enlarged, then it again become narrow, and in the lumbar region to supply the lumbar areas, that is the lower limb, it again gets enlarged to form the lumbosacral enlargement and supplies the lower limb. At the distal end it presents conus medullaris, that is the thin conical end of the spinal cord, cauda equina, in which the nerve roots extending below the conus medullaris and resembles the horse tail. That is why it is named as cauda equina. Cauda means tail, equina means horse tail. Then the phylum terminale, it is a thin thread of fibrous tissue at the end of the conus medullaris, and it is attached to the coccygeal ligament. So here we can see the conus medullaris and the appearance of a horse tail appearance known as cauda equina. Then the applied related to this is poliomyelitis. It is a highly infectious viral disease which destructs the motor neurons and damages the brain and the spinal cord, and is characterized by muscle weakness and paralysis. Poliomyelitis is the inflammation of the gray anterior matter of the spinal cord, which leads to death of the motor neurons, and the sensory neurons are unaffected. Now here are some terms related to the spinal cord, like the ganglion. Ganglion is what? It is the collection of nerve cell body outside the CNS, and corresponding to it, collection of nerve cell body inside the CNS is known as nucleus. CNS means brain and the spinal cord. Then there is a term known as nerve. Nerve is what? It is the collection of axons outside the CNS, and the collection of axons inside the CNS is known as tract. Now this is the organization of the spinal cord, in which we have taken the transverse section of the spinal cord. In this we find the capital H shaped gray matter. This gray matter is surrounded by the white matter outside. So this white matter is organized in three forms: the anterior side, is known as ventral column. On the posterior side, it is known as dorsal column. And on the lateral side, it is known as lateral column. Then the gray column is also organized in the similar way. The anterior part is known as ventral gray column. Posterior part is known as dorsal gray column. And in the thoracic region, here a small process is found which is known as lateral gray column. Then these two columns on the right and the left, they are connected with each other through the gray commissure over here. And the white columns are also connected with each other on the anterior as well as posterior side by a white commissure. So this is the anterior white commissure, that is known as ventral white commissure. And on the posterior side, this is known as dorsal white commissure. What is gray matter? Gray matter means the collection of nerve cell bodies and the blood vessel, due to which the color of the area of this particular part is become gray in color. And white matter is what? It is the collection of nerve cell fibers which are myelinated, because myelin sheath is white in color, that is why this area appears white in color, and it is devoid of blood vessels. So this is the difference between the gray and the white matter. So this is described again in this slide, that is anterior median fissure. Anterior median fissure is this deep cleft on the anterior side. This is the anterior median fissure. On the posterior side, we have again the cleft which is not so deep. This is known as dorsal median sulcus. Then this is the arrangement or the organization of roots from the spinal cord. From the anterior gray column, there arises the ventral rootlets, and from the posterior gray column, there arises the dorsal roots. These roots combine together and forms trunk. This trunk again bifurcates to form the primary dorsal ramus on the posterior side and ventral ramus on the anterior side. The dorsal ramus supplies to the posterior side of the body and ventral ramus supplies to the anterior side of the body. So this is the formation of the spinal nerve, how spinal nerve forms from the spinal cord. Now ventral root, it is motor in function because it contains motor neurons. Dorsal root contains sensory neurons, and there is dorsal root ganglion on the posterior side which is containing the pseudo unipolar type of neurons. So this is again the formation of the spinal nerve. On the posterior side, we have the dorsal root ganglion which is containing the pseudo unipolar neurons, and on the anterior side we have motor neurons. This is the organization of the spinal cord within the vertebral column. So in the vertebral canal, here lies the spinal cord surrounded by the meninges. These are the regions of the spinal cord and the corresponding vertebral level. For example, the upper cervical region of the spinal cord, the C2, corresponds to the C2 vertebral level. As we go downwards, the vertebral level becomes decreased. For example, in the upper thoracic region, that is at the level of T5 spinal nerve, the vertebral level, the vertebra where this spinal nerve lies, is -2, that is T3. In the similar way, in the lower thoracic segment, for example, at the level of T10, the vertebral level at which this spinal nerve lies, you have to -3, that is T7. So this is the formula for acquiring the vertebral level of a particular spinal segment. Now there are protective structures for the spinal cord. These are the meninges. We have three meninges: outermost dura mater, then arachnoid, and the innermost is pia mater. There is a space known as epidural space which is lying outside the dura mater, subdural space which is lying deep to the dura mater and lies between dura mater and the arachnoid. Then there is a third space known as subarachnoid space which is lying between arachnoid and the pia mater, and it is filled with CSF. So these are the three meninges depicted in this diagram: outermost, the dura mater, then arachnoid, and then pyameter. Here we have reflected the dura mater, and arachnoid and pyameter are seen. Now first we consider about the dura mater. It is dense, strong fibrous membrane. It encloses the spinal cord and caudic vena. It is continuous above with the meningeal layer of the dura covering the brain. It ends at the level of S2 vertebrae. It is separated from the wall of the vertebral canal by the extradural space. So the space between the vertebral canal and the dura mater is known as extradural space, and it is filled with internal vertebral venous plexus and loose areolar tissue. So this is the epidural space, this yellowish area which is filled with loose areolar tissue and internal vertebral venous plexus. Then inside the dura mater we have arachnoid matter. It is a delicate impermeable membrane which lies between a pyameter and the dura mater. It is separated from pyameter by subarachnoid space and continuous above with the arachnoid matter covering the brain. It ends at the level of S2 vertebrae. Then pyameter. It is a vascular membrane. It is very closely adherent to the spinal cord, and it is thickened on either side of the nerve roots to form ligamentum denticulatum. So in the diagram we have shown the ligamentum denticulatum. This is the fold of pyameter. Then spinal nerves. There are 31 pair of the spinal nerves, and these are mixed nerves. These are motor and sensory as well. And these are 8 cervical spinal nerves, 12 thoracic spinal nerves. These are in pairs. So 5 pair of the lumbar nerves, 5 pair of the sacral nerves, and 1 pair of the coccygeal nerve. These nerves are surrounded by the connective tissue layers, that is apineurium, perineurium, and endoneurium. The outermost is the apineurium, inside that perineurium, and the innermost is endoneurium. And the nerve fibers are arranged in bundles. These bundles are known as fascicles. So in the diagram we can see how the formation of nerve occurs. Nerve is formed by the collection of axons, and here we can see there is a collection of axons which is forming one bundle. This bundle is known as fascicle. This fascicle is surrounded by the perineurium, and the axon is surrounded by the endoneurium. There are different fascicles which enclosed by the epineurium, and these fascicles, when enclosed by epineurium, it is known as nerve. So this is the formation of spinal nerve. Now distribution of the spinal nerves. Spinal nerves branch, and their branches are known as rami. That is, we have discussed in the previous slide, ventral ramus and dorsal ramus, and they form also plexus. Except T1 to T11 spinal nerves, they do not form any plexus. So this is the organization of the spinal nerve. In the cervical region, that is in the neck region, we have cervical plexus. The most important them is the phrenic nerve, which is supplying the diaphragm. Then the upper limb, we have the brachial plexus, which supplies the upper limb. In the lumbar region, we have the lumbar plexus, which supply the lower limb, and the external genitalia, and the anterolateral abdominal walls. In the sacral region, we have the sacral plexus, which supplies the buttocks, perineum, and the lower part of the lower limb. Then in the coccygeal region, we have the coccygeal nerves, which supply the area near the coccygeal region. Then there is another term known as dermatome. Dermatome is the area of the skin which is supplied by a pair of spinal nerves. That area is known as dermatome. Dermatome, derma means skin. Now the gray matter, as we have discussed earlier, it is a pillar of anterior and posterior gray horns, which are united by the gray commissure. And in the central, there is a pore known as central canal. The lateral gray column present in thoracic and upper lumbar regions. Amount of gray matter related to the amount of muscle innervated. So if there is more muscles innervation, then the gray matter is more in that particular region. It consists of nerve cell body, neuroglial cells, as well as blood vessels. So these three structures are found in the gray matter. Because of the presence of blood vessel, this area appears gray in color. That is why it is named as gray matter. So in this transverse section, we have this capital H shaped area is the gray matter of the spinal cord. Then this is the central canal. The central canal is filled with CSF. It is lined with ependymoma and it is continuous with the ventricular system of the brain above. And it opens into the fourth ventricle above, and inferiorly it ends in the conus medullaris. Conus medullaris, again the tapering end of the spinal cord. Then in the conus medullaris, this central canal again expands to form the terminal ventricle. It terminates below at the level of phylum terminale. So here we can see the terminal ventricle, and this is again the transverse section of the spinal cord where we can see the gray matter and the white matter. The white matter contains the nerve fibers and the neuroglial cells only. There is no blood vessel is found. So in this we have arranged the gray matter into dorsal ramus, dorsal horn, ventral horn and the lateral horn. Dorsal horn is sensory, ventral horn of the gray matter is motor because it is containing motor nuclei, and lateral horn, which we have discussed earlier, it is only found in the thorax, upper thoracic and lumbar regions, and it is containing the visceral motor nuclei. Visceral means the organs. So this lateral gray horn, it supplies only the viscerals. So this is the dorsal horn, this is ventral horn, and this is lateral horn. These are the parts of gray matter. Then the commissures. We have gray commissure, the transverse bridge of gray matter connecting the anterior and the posterior gray horn each other like this. This is the gray commissure, and it is pierced by the central canal. Then there is white commissure, which lies ventral to the gray commissure and contains decussating nerve fibers. So this is white commissure. Then the cells of the same type are clustered into groups which occur in long columns. In transverse section, these columns appear as layers, especially within the dorsal horn. These layers are known as laminae of Rechst, and they are numbered by Roman numerals, starting from the tip of the dorsal horn, that is from here. Then these are again, we have showed in this image, the different laminae of the spinal cord. Now we discuss the nuclei in these laminae. Nuclei in the anterior gray horn, they innervate the skeletal muscles, and they are arranged in three groups: medial, lateral and central. The medial group is present throughout the entire extent of the spinal cord and innervates the axial muscles. Axial muscles are those muscles which are attached on the axial skeleton, that is the muscle of face, muscles of neck and the thorax. Then the lateral group, it is only present in the cervical and the lumbar region to supply the muscles of limbs, upper and the lower. Then central group, it is only present in the upper cervical segment as phrenic nerve nucleus and the nucleus of the spinal root of accessory nerve. Accessory nerve is the 11th cranial nerve. So these are the three different nuclei in the ventral gray horn: the central, the medial and the lateral. Lateral is further divided into anterolateral and posteriolateral. So nuclei in the lateral horn, there are two nuclei in the lateral horn, as we can see in the diagram, the intermedial and the intermediolateral. They control the autonomic nervous system and innervates the viscera. Viscera means the organs. Then in the posterior horn, we have nucleus posterior marginalis, the posterior most nucleus, we can see in the diagram. Then substantia gelatinosa, anterior to it nucleus properius and dorsal nucleus of thoracic nucleus. So these are the nuclei and the Rechst laminae. Then posterior marginal nucleus, it is corresponding to Rechst laminae number 1, and it is a thin layer of neurons covers the tip of the posterior horn. It receives the incoming fibers of pain and temperature. Then substantia gelatinosa, it is corresponding to Rechst laminae number 2. It is located at the apex of horn and is composed of large neurons. It is present throughout the length of the spinal cord. It is also concerned with receiving the fibers of pain and temperature. Then nucleus properius, it is corresponding to laminae number 3 and 4. It is also present throughout the spinal cord, and the dorsal root fibers, they are concerned with senses of position and movement. Then this is Clark's nucleus, corresponding to laminae number 5 and 6. located at the base of the dorsal horn, extend from C8 to L3, L4, associated with proprioceptive endings. Then visceral afferent nucleus corresponding to lamina number 7, and it also extends from T1 to L3, afferent received from visceral afferents, that is from the organs. So these are the different laminae and their corresponding nuclei. Then the white matter. White matter consists of mixture of nerve fibers, neuroglia and blood vessels. White color is due to myelinated nerve fibers. The white matter is of arranged in columns, that is anterior white column, posterior white column and the lateral white column. The nerve fibers are arranged in bundles running vertically throughout the cord. So there are three columns, anterior, posterior and lateral. In the diagram we can see this is posterior column, lateral column and this is anterior column. Then a group of nerve fibers that share a common origin, termination and function. This is known as tract. So this is the definition of tract. These tract can be sensory, which is ascending to the brain. These tract can be motor, which is descending from the brain, and fibers of connector neurons. These tract are often named according to their points of origin and insertion. Insertion means destination. Example, spinothalamic. So it originates from the spinal cord and ends in the thalamus. That is why it is named as spinothalamic. Similarly, corticospinal. So it arises from the cortex, that is cerebral cortex, and ends in the spinal cord. That is why it is named as corticospinal. Then these tracts are three types: ascending, descending and intersegmental tracts. Ascending tracts, the fibers that ascend from the spinal cord to the higher centrals, and they conduct the afferent information which may or may not reach consciousness. Information may be pain temperature, exteroceptive. It may be from muscle and joints, that is proprioceptive. Then the organization. Ascending tract contains three types of neurons: first order, second order and the third order. First order neurons, it delivers the sensation to the CNS and it lies in the dorsal root ganglion of the spinal cord. Second order neurons, it is located in the spinal cord or in the brainstem. Then third order neuron, it lies in the thalamus. And from here, the information reaches up to the cortex, cerebral cortex. Now these are the different ascending tracts. For example, lateral spinothalamic tract, it is concerned with pain and temperature sensations. Anterior spinothalamic tract, it is concerned with crude touch and pressure. Then fasciculus gracilis and cuneatus, associated with discriminatory touch, vibration and information from the muscle and the joints. Anterior spinocerebellar tract, posterior spinocerebellar tract, it is unconscious information from muscle, joint and skin. Then another is spinotactile tract. It is concerned with spinovisual reflexes. Spinoreticular tract, information from muscles, joint, skin to the spinal cord, to reticular information and then to the thalamus. And it is responsible for automatic responses to pain, such as in the case of injury. There is another tract known as spinoalivary. It is an indirect pathway to the cerebellum. This tract carries proprioceptive information from the muscle and tendons as well as cutaneous impulses to the olivary nucleus. So these tracts are arranged in this transverse section. The particular area of the tract is colored or highlighted with a particular color. Then this is the spinothalamic tract. So here we discuss about its location. It is located in the lateral and the ventral horn of the spinal cord. It carries information for the pain and temperature and non-discriminative touch and pressure. Then in the brainstem, it constitutes the lameniscus, spinal lameniscus. So in the brainstem, spinothalamic tract is known as spinal lameniscus. Information is sent to the primary sensory cortex on the opposite side of the body. So we discuss about the lateral spinothalamic tract. This lateral spinothalamic tract has the function for carrying pain and temperature sensation to the thalamus. This is the function. And then we discuss the pathway, how the pain and temperature reaches to the thalamus or the brain. So there is first neuron, first order neuron, it is lying in the dorsal root ganglion. Second order neuron, it is lying in the substantia gelatinosa of Ronaldi, in the posterior horn. Substantia gelatinosa we have just read in the previous images. So second order neuron is lying in the substantia gelatinosa. Then third order neuron lies in the thalamus. In the thalamus we have different kinds of nucleus. This pain and temperature sensation lies in the VPL nucleus, ventroposterior lateral nucleus. Then from here, this information reaches to the contralateral side of the cerebral cortex. Contralateral means opposite side. So if you are receiving pain and temperature from left side, this information reaches to the right side of the cerebral cortex, because the representation is contralateral in the brain. So this is the lateral spinothalamic tract from dorsal root ganglion. This is first order. Then the second order is lying in the substantia gelatinosa, which is lying in the spinal cord. And the third order is lying in the thalamus. Then the next tract is anterior spinothalamic tract. It carries the sensation of crude touch and pressure, tickle and itching. First order is same, that is, it is lying in the dorsal root ganglion. Then these relay by synapsing with the neurons lying in the gray matter, that in the nucleus proprius. So second order neuron lie in the nucleus proprius. Then from this second order neuron, fibers reaches to the thalamus. Then third order neuron lies in the thalamus. So here we can see the anterior spinothalamic tract, first order in the dorsal root ganglion. Then from here, the fibers reaches to the nucleus proprius. Then the fibers reaches to the thalamus. This is another diagrammatic representation of anterior spinothalamic tract. Then in the posterior white column, we have discriminative touch, vibratory sense, conscious muscle joint sense, that is conscious proprioception fibers. See, the spinal cord is completely made up of nerve fibers and the nerve cell body. So don't get confused. All these are nerve fibers. So in the posterior white column, we have two type of tracts, that is fasciculus gracilis on the medial side and fasciculus cuneatus on the lateral side. Fasciculus gracilis is receiving the fibers from lower limb and cuneatus receiving the fibers from upper limb. So first we discuss about the fasciculus cuneatus, the modality, which kind of sensation it will receiving. It is the fine touch, vibration and proprioception from the upper body, that is the upper limb. These origin axons arise from dorsal root ganglion, as in the case. Then location, it is lying in the lateral dorsal column of the T5 to C1. So this is the fasciculus cuneatus posterior white column. The first order neuron lies in the dorsal root ganglion. Then second order neuron in the nucleus gracilis of medulla oblongata. Then third order neuron lies in the thalamus. Dorsal column pathways and medial lemniscus is one and the same thing. Dorsal column pathways in the brainstem is known as medial lemniscus. So this is the dorsal column pathway again. Then come to the descending tract. Those tracts which are ascending, they also descend, but most of them the important tract is corticospinal tract. It is concerned with voluntary, distinct and skilled movements, that is fine movements. So it starts from the motor cortex, that is the cerebral cortex. Then the fibers reaches to the cerebral peduncles, that is the part of midbrain. From here they descend downwards and reaches to the medulla. In the medulla it forms the two elevations, which is known as pyramid. Then these fibers from the pyramid cross to the opposite side and reaches to the ventral gray column of the spinal cord, and this is then supplying to the motor nerve, that is the ventral gray root, and then it is supplying to the muscles. So corticospinal tract, it is the major function of this tract is the fine voluntary motor control of the limbs. The main effector or motor neuron for the voluntary movement is lying within the fifth layer of the motor cortex. Motor cortex means the cerebrum. In the cerebrum, we have six layers of different kinds of neurons. The corticospinal tract arises in the fifth layer. This is the fifth layer, which is known as cells of Batts. The cells have their bodies in the cerebral cortex. The nerve axons travel from the cortex through the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Here we can see it is passing through the internal capsule. It is lying in the cerebrum itself. Then it reaches to the brainstem. Brainstem lies between the cerebrum and the spinal cord. So this is the cerebrum, this is the spinal cord. In between these two, this is the brainstem. So in the brainstem, it passes through the crust cerebri of the midbrain. It is passing through the pons, medulla, and then reaches to the pyramids of the medulla. So this is the diagram of internal capsule. For this, we have taken the transverse section of the cerebrum, and here we find different nuclei, that is caudate nuclei, thalamus, globus pallidus, putamen. These are the nuclei of internal capsule. So this is the, this red color line is the internal capsule. So there are six layers in the cerebral cortex, as we have discussed earlier, and our corticospinal tract arises from the fifth layer, that is from this layer. So this tract arises from this fifth layer of the motor cortex, passes through the internal capsule. This is the internal capsule, then reaches to the midbrain. In the midbrain, it lies in the cerebral peduncle, then reaches the pyramids of the medulla, and then reaches to the gray horn of the spinal cord. This is the how corticospinal descent. Then from here, it forms the ventral root. This is the ventral root. Then ventral root supplies to the muscle, because corticospinal tract is a motor tract. It is concerned with skillful movements, and the movements are done by the muscles. So this is the corticospinal tract again. This is a diagram for how you have to draw the corticospinal tract in your exam. So this is the again animatic representation of the corticospinal tract. Suppose you want to flex your elbow, then how this flexion occurs. So first of all, the fibers arises from the fifth layer of the cerebral cortex, then it passes through the internal capsule, then it reaches to the medulla, then fibers from here reaches to the spinal cord, and from here the information is transferred through the ventral root of the spinal cord to the muscle, and then muscle causes the flexion. Suppose this muscle. This is the diagrammatic representation in the original cerebral cortex, the formation of the internal capsule. Then the next tract is corticobulbar tract. It is arising in the brainstem, and it is concerned with the motor signals to the muscles of face and neck. Then other descending tracts are reticulospinal tract, tectospinal, rubrospinal, and vestibular tract. So you just go through their functions. And these tracts are enclosed in this diagram. This is the spinal cord transverse section, in which we have highlighted different tracts. Then arterial supply of the spinal cord, it is supplied by the anterior spinal and the posterior spinal arteries, branches of vertebral artery. So here we can see. Then venous drainage is by internal vertebral venous pectus. Then the applied is lumbar puncture. It is also known as spinal tap. For clinical examination of CSF or administration of radio opaque dyes, drugs, some anesthetics, they transfer this needle in the intervertebral disc between L3 and L4 for reaching up to the subarachnoid space, and they drain from here the CSF for examination. This is the lumbar puncture. Then lower motor neurons and upper motor neurons. The upper motor neurons lies in the motor cortex. That is why they are known as upper motor neurons. And the lower motor neurons, they lie in the brainstem or spinal cord. Now the clinical anatomy related to these neurons. Upper motor neurons are motor neurons, and they are originate in the motor region of the cerebral cortex or in the brainstem, and they carry motor information down to the lower motor neurons. The blind related to this is upper motor neuron syndrome. It is the motor control changes that occur in skeletal muscle after motor neuron lesion. So if there is injury, lesion means injury to the upper motor neurons, it will cause exaggerated tendon reflexes. Why? Due to the increase in the muscle stretch. And clonus means a series of involuntary rapid muscle contraction. The muscle becomes rapidly contract, involuntary means not under our control. Then there is lower motor neuron lesion. In case of lower motor neuron injury, this is the neural palsy, which affects the nerve fibers traveling from ventral horn of the spinal cord to the relevant muscle, and it will result into small groups of muscles which is affecting the muscle atrophy. Muscle atrophy means the size of the muscle becomes small, it becomes weak, there become fasciculations and fibrillation. Fasciculation means spontaneous contractions are there. Then fibrillation, individual muscle fibers become contract without coordination. There is hypotonia and hyporeflexia in case of lower motor injury. This is the table for showing you the differences between upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron lesion injuries. So just go through it, is very simple, and we have discussed it earlier in the previous slides. Then other syndromes of the spinal cord, these are Brown sequoid, central cord syndrome. So this is complete cord transection. So if the transverse section, so if there is injury to the spinal cord at a particular level, if there is complete injury to the spinal cord, then all these tract at that particular level of the spinal cord become damaged. So this is complete cord transection. For example, there is injury is occurring at the level of T5 vertebrae, and there is emerging the T5 spinal nerve. If there is injury to the complete that segment of the spinal cord, then below T5 there is complete paralysis. Above T5 is patent. Above T5 is normal, but below that there is complete paralysis of the body. The causes for complete transection of the spinal cord may be trauma, injury, it may be metastatic carcinoma, it may be autoimmune disorder. All ascending tracts below and descending tracts above are interpreted and affects motor, sensory and autonomic functions. Sensations, all sensations are affected. There will be motor paraplegia due to corticospinal tract. Paraplegia means paralysis of lower limb. Then next is Brown sequoid syndrome, but means hemisection of the spinal cord, means half of the spinal cord is damaged. So patients with Brown sequoid syndrome, they suffer from ipsilateral on the same side, upper motor neuron paralysis, loss of proprioception, as well as contralateral loss of pain and temperature sensation. So this is the diagram to show you the Brown sequoid syndrome. In this, half of the spinal cord is damaged. So on the half of the spinal cord, the tracts are injured. Then this is the central cord syndrome. In this, the area around the central canal, this is damaged because of the enlargement of the central canal. Now what are the causes for enlargement of the central canal? It may be syringomyelia or it may be hyperextension of the neck. In syringomyelia, there is fluid filled cyst formation occurs in the spinal cord. And in case of hyperextension of neck, this is injured during extension injury. So these are the different tracts which are affecting in the dilatation of the spinal cord, dilatation of the central canal of the spinal cord. Suppose there is injury or engulfment of the posterior white column, or there is engulfment of the corticospinal tract. Then central cord, these are the causes, syringomyelia, and the changes are, there are sensory changes, sensory loss of pain and temperature, touch and pressure, dissociative sensory loss will be there, and there is motor loss also, there is upper limb weakness. Next is posterior column syndrome or TBS dorsalis. It occurs due to neurosyphilis or diabetes mellitus. In this, it occurs after 10 to 20 years after infection. In this, the posterior white column of the spinal cord is damaged. And we know posterior white column is controlling our proprioceptive sensations of lower limb and upper limb. So if there is injury to the posterior white column, it will lead to loss of pain, loss of vibration and proprioceptive sensation. So this is the impaired position and vibration sense in the lower limb, and there is numbness and paresthesia. These are the frequent complaints, and there is positive Romberg sign. Positive Romberg sign means the person is unable to stand straight without looking towards the lower limb, without looking towards the foot. Then anterior cord syndrome means if there is blockage in the anterior spinal artery, the anterior part of the spinal cord gets injured. So all the tracts which are found in the anterior white column, they are interrupted. And it is because of the blockage in the anterior spinal artery, that is why it is also known as anterior spinal artery syndrome. This is anterior cord syndrome area. So the signs and symptoms include the loss of pain and temperature, sensation at the level and below the level of the injury because of injury to the spinal cord, spinothalamic tract. There is complete motor paralysis below the level of injury due to the interruption of the corticospinal tract. So this is the anterior cord syndrome. Then the questions related to this topic, there are numerous questions, but the most important are Brown sequoid syndrome. In this you have to mention about the hemisection of the spinal cord, then the anatomical features of the spinal cord. Then the third question is corticospinal tract. In this you have to mention about the detailed note on the corticospinal tract along with the diagram. Then for your file you have to draw this diagram. This is the transverse section of the spinal cord, and here we have included all the tracts, ascending or descending tracts in the spinal cord. So this completes the topic, the spinal cord. Thank you.